This week on Wealth Track, the prospects for oil in an uncertain world. Will the Arab Spring lead to new shortages of petroleum? Will a global slowdown dramatically cut oil demand? Find out what star oil analyst Charlie Maxwell is forecasting next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
The company you keep is also the company we keep. Together, we help provide a lifetime of guaranteed income and investment solutions.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally, research affiliates, an efficient index for an inefficient market, Wintergreen, your home for global value, and Rosalind P. Walter.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. No matter how you toss it, oil still matters. Yes, the price of oil has dropped precipitously this year, along with other commodities in the face of a slowing global economy. West Texas Intermediate, the traditional U.S. benchmark, has fallen about 25% from its spring highs. But according to this week's guest, the fundamentals of supply and demand do not hold out much hope of any sort of sustained drop from here. Black gold is still the dominant source of fuel in the world. According to the U.S. Energy Information Administration, it accounts for more than a third of world energy consumption, followed by coal and natural gas, and dwarfing nuclear and other alternative energy sources. And according to the IEA, by 2030, that energy pie shouldn't look that different, except for a couple of more percent from alternative sources and a few less from oil. Which means the uprisings in the Middle East are of more than just political and human rights interest. The outcomes can make the difference between affordable or expensive oil and surplus or shortage. As our guest this week, veteran oil analyst Charles Maxwell points out, 10 nations that control some 16% of the world's daily production have serious internal political problems. They range from sizable producers such as Iran, Iraq, Venezuela, Nigeria, and Libya, to smaller producers such as Syria and Egypt. And we haven't even mentioned the fact that non-OPEC oil production, including in the U.S., has already peaked, and predictions are that production will peak in other regions over the next 10 years or so. This all makes the life of an oil analyst challenging, to say the least. But Charlie Maxwell, senior energy analyst at Weeden & Company, has the experience and knowledge to sort it all out. A student of Middle East language, literature, and history at Oxford, he began his career working for Mobil Oil in 1957 with posts in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa. He became an oil analyst in 1968 and has been ranked number one in his field 9 times over the years. In a recent interview, I asked Charlie why oil should be on our radar screens.
Oil is so involved in our lives. It's the largest single source of energy that we have among all the big sources. It's about 36% of total energy used on the planet is still oil. So it's terribly important to us that we have continuous and even growing supplies of oil. And my work suggests that continuous is not really likely in the present political environment, and growing probably not likely in the natural environment in which Mother Nature is beginning to question whether we can continue to lift oil production when we have so many old oil fields that are beginning to contribute their negative volumes.
So let's start with the political aspects first. And I know you told me that 10 countries that are known for oil production have serious internal political problems. And I'm thinking of not only the Arab Spring, but other issues as well with Iran and Venezuela.
Yes, indeed.
So what is the potential impact of these internal political problems that there are in some of the major oil producers of the world?
Well, the key point is that we have about 89 million barrels a day of production going on now in the world, and we'll have averaged that for the year. And In that, we have about 6 more million barrels a day that are surplus to our needs.
So that's our margin of safety.
That's
6
our margin
million
of safety.
Barrels a day. Yep.
And of that 6 million, actually about 1.5 million barrels a day are of high sulfur, very sludgy, dense types of oil that no refinery wants or can afford to run because it cleans out the inside of the refinery and pits the surfaces.
So we're down to a margin of 4.5.
So now we're down to about 4.5.
Yeah.
And then we have Libya that dropped out about a little bit more than 1. So now we're down to about 3.25. And then we need about 2 million barrels a day to operate the system on the inventory requirements. So we're down to something like 1 to 1.5 million barrels a day. That's all that's actually extra to our needs. And that just isn't enough. Any one of these 10 countries going down will make a difference. And 2 or 3 of them go down, and they've gone down in the past. Then we're going to be tight, and suddenly we're going to be back on higher prices.
So with oil prices now, it's been ranging somewhere between, what, 80 and 90?
Yeah, five.
$95 a barrel. And actually, so what do you think, looking at the global supply-demand picture right now, what do you think that a fair price of oil is?
Well, in the spring, last April, with all of these problems that we had on the political side, we did get up to 112. And now we've gotten down recently to about 79. So I think that the right price, the economic price, but we're not going to get necessarily an economic price, but what it would be something between $70 and $90 a barrel, running back and forth on a basis of a little more recession or a little less recession, a little bit colder summer, hotter summer, that kind of thing. But with these political aspects coming in all the time, we're really quite unable to know exactly when they explode. But they are definitely showing us the way to 100 and 110 and 120 at some time, perhaps next year or the year after.
So as you told me, I mean, earlier, is that we're kind of running on the edge as far
yes.
as supply is concerned right now.
Now, this would be a very good time to begin to accumulate some of the kind of oil stocks that you want to have with lots of reserves in the ground to get over the problems that are definitely coming out there in 2013, 14, 15, 16. We get into a point where the big oil companies cannot expand their production. Then suddenly the world begins to say, this oil is becoming very valuable very quickly.
So let's talk about just a little bit longer term, because it really isn't that far away. This whole notion of Hubbard's Peak, that named after the gentleman who predicted that world oil production would turn over, essentially would start to decline. And at one point, you were talking about 2015 to 2020, with the developed world slowing down, it might be a little bit farther away than that. But how real is that, and what will the impact be on oil prices?
Well, I think the range is still all right. I'd been looking at 215 or 216, and we've always had a 215 to 220 range. Now I'd push it back a little, maybe to 217, 218. But still, it looks like Hubbard's Peak will be within that 215, 220 range. That's almost right in front of us, you know.
Right.
Because in the boardrooms, when oil companies decide that they're going to go into a new play in some part of the world, it averages now about 5 to 7 years before they can get the oil and gas on stream.
There are critics or naysayers out there who say, look, oil is just like any other commodity, and that a couple of things are going to happen. One is that people will start to conserve more, and so the demand will go down. That somehow we'll find alternative sources of energy that will fill in the gap when oil reaches a certain point. And also there's this whole reversion to the mean that eventually, you know, oil prices will revert to their long-term average and it's going to be much lower than what it is now. What do you say to them who are saying, you know, don't worry, you know, the cycle will take care of it?
Those are three good reasons. And one has to, there has to be an answer to them. And the first one was that conservation will come in and take over and will. Yes, it will, but the conservation won't be because Mr. Carter is up in front of us with a sweater imploring us and telling us that this is the moral equivalent of war. It
right.
will come with higher prices. So that's where, of course, the investment comes in, because the higher prices are going to be very attractive to people who already hold these oil companies, who will have much higher values attached to their reserves. So yes, there is going to be conservation, and yes, it's going to come in, and it will slow down the need for a lot more oil, thank God, but it will be at the cost of $130 a barrel, $180 a barrel. I think by 2020, in money of the day, it may be as much as $300 a barrel. But that would be about $220 a barrel today. And that is quite manageable, I think, because we've already been at 147 back in 2008. So for 12 years, 225 is not too much.
So you said earlier that we should be preparing our portfolios with the eventuality of higher oil prices and this
yes.
this lack of supply. So advise
well,
us, how should we be preparing our portfolios?
Well, some people would say right off, well, we'll switch over to coal. That's the way to prepare your portfolio, or switch over to nuclear. But I think it's a question of timing. I'm looking for this problem to occur in oil, which will then require a lot more of the other things. So we are preparing, are we not, a lot of nuclear today. Everyone's going nuclear. More nations are going nuclear every day.
Even after Japan.
No, there aren't any going nuclear.
No, I was going to say, they're not.
It's all the other way. So we're just being funny here.
Oh, I'm sorry, cross that off our list.
But so what about coal? Well, we can use a lot more coal, and we have a lot more coal, but coal is a problem because of the emissions and because it doesn't burn cleanly and because we don't know yet how to put it, the gases underground in sequestration, and it's not economic when you have to do that. So suddenly we're letting down on the coal side, we're letting down on the nuclear side. Maybe wind power can come in and do it.
Well, let me put something ahead of wind power. What about natural gas, which we have a lot of in this country?
Well, I'm getting there
because All right. Sorry.
That's the winner.
I'll go in your order, go ahead.
So the alternative of solar and wind and so on, too small. Too small.
What is it still? Is it still 1%?
Yes, it's about 1.5%, and solar is maybe a quarter of a percent. So
it's a tiny fraction.
Tiny fraction of the total
of our energy supply.
So, and water doesn't expand very quickly because most of the good places for water power are already been taken. So it's hard to increase that rapidly. The result is that we're left with two big potential solutions to the problem. The first is natural gas, and the second is energy efficiency and conservation. And those will be the two ways out, but it will take about 20 to 30 years to mobilize them, for people to understand what's coming, to set the tax situation in such a way that these are encouraged. Right now, we're pretending that natural gas is not going to be the way out. And we're pretending that conservation is unimportant. If we thought it was really important, we would have found ways to bring that conservation quickly to the fore. We need every year that we can get of conservation before the doomsday scenario hits. Now, I don't think it'll ever be doomsday, but it will be very harsh for us. So I think in the next 10 to 15 years, we have a timing problem. We're going to lose the oil, but we don't have the other things ready to go. And that will give us a lot of problems in energy for the next 15 to 20 years. on the other side of it, we will have solved those problems and we'll be back in good days.
So how do we participate in oil as an investor?
Well, the easy way to explain this is to say that each company has its own reserves, and that some companies have very large reserves and have a low value in the market, and some have high values in the market and very few reserves. So the way I do it is to look at $100 and ask the question of the company, how many barrels comes with $100 worth of Exxon? How many barrels comes with $100 worth of Occidental? How many barrels comes? And the differences are extraordinary. For instance, in the case of Suncor, the Canadian Athabasca tar sands company,
which has been a longtime favorite of yours.
Which has been a longtime favorite. It's currently about 44 barrels per $100.
And this is $100 of stock.
$100 of stock.
Right.
So each company has the same $100.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so the barrels make a difference. Now, Exxon has about 7 barrels.
Wow.
Per $100.
Huge
so
difference.
So you get something like 6 to 7 times as many barrels when you buy $100 of Suncor than you get with Exxon. That will make a huge difference as we get into this tightness in the market and lack of barrels.
So, and there's another aspect to this as well, because I can think of, you know, people who have said, you know, buy the majors, number one, you know, they're strong, they're global, they pay dividends. So what about, you know, that aspect to, you know, to the total investment, you know, picture when you look at some of these companies as well?
Well, of course, we have to throw in something that is different than just looking at barrels. You have to look at the management's mm-hmm. Ability to manage. You have to look at the balance sheet. You have to look at the political agendas of the people. For instance, probably the greatest raw material holder in the world is Gazprom in Russia. But we don't even include it in our list because we think it is a political institution, not an economic institution.
Right.
And that is the problem with a company like Lukoil, which is doing a really fine job with its oil management, but is still, we think, part of the Russian system and therefore perhaps biased towards set artificial prices and manipulation by the government. So, but Lukoil and Gazprom at some stage may become regular companies, and if they did, I'd be very excited by their appearance as real commercial entities.
So you want to also to have a company that basically where their reserves are in safe, politically
yes,
safe areas?
And many of the companies have reserves abroad that are not in safe areas. Now, Suncor and Cenovus, my two favorites.
Another Canadian-based company,
right. Other Canadian-based companies, they have their reserves essentially in the Athabasca oil sands of northern Alberta, right across the border from us in western Canada.
And Cenovus, what does $100 buy you with Cenovus?
About 24 barrels, which is still much better than the average oil company, which is probably around 9 or 10.
So let me ask you then, and I know one of those companies is going to be your one investment. So what is your one investment that all of us should own some of in a long-term diversified portfolio if we should buy an oil company, which you and our recent guest, Robert Shiller, also said that we should all own some oil in our portfolios, whether it be through an oil company or just the commodity itself?
Well, these two companies are so similar. Both being Canadian, both being fast-growing, both having huge reserves that are 6 or 7 times the average oil company's reserves for the same amount of money, both having immense growth potential, it would be very hard for me to separate them. But I think Suncor or Cenovus are going to be the leaders in growth, the leaders in growth of profitability as well as growth of volumes. They're going to be very much prized because their reserves are in a neighboring country that is very friendly to the United States and is helpful and is a democracy and whom we have very close relations over hundreds of years. So I would just have to say that I can't separate them, but they're both very good, and they are the two that should be bought because they are the ones that are have developed along the road to major production.
Let me ask you about conservation, and I'm going to ask you a couple more questions. You're a huge advocate of conservation, and so tell me what difference conservation really could make and how soon it's going to make a difference.
It really isn't fair to include it as a fuel, but it acts like a fuel, because if we can save a barrel, it's like finding a barrel. And actually, if you save a barrel, because of all the energy costs of getting the barrel to the point where you're going to use it, it's probably about saving 1.5 or 1.25 barrels, better 1.25 barrels. So saving a barrel turns out to be terribly important, and we have use of oil that is based on very low prices, and we will find 1,000 ways to conserve it. The mind of man is open in this case, and it will take just higher prices and a lot of good old-fashioned American innovation to send us rolling along this route. Now, everyone in the world will participate, but we should be the leader.
And you know, what about this notion of energy independence? I mean, how realistic is the goal of energy independence in the United States?
Alas, not at all. We just can't do it. Like so many other things, we may think that we can grow cinnamon in the United States, but actually we can't. We have to import it. And we have to import so many foods, and we have to import all kinds of energy sources also.
So what is a realistic goal to at least lessen our dependence on energy imports from countries that, number one, are unstable politically and also hostile to the United States?
Well, we cannot depend on oil, so we're going to have to depend on conservation and natural gas. And natural gas has a huge role to play along with conservation, so we should be sure to put it on an equal pedestal. We will find ways to use natural gas in cars and trucks by converting it into liquids that can be added to the gasoline and added to the diesel that will be synthetic diesel, and that will work very well. It'll take 5 to 10 to 15 years to get it economic. We'll get it going, but it won't be economic, and then eventually it'll become economic. And that's one area we will learn to compress natural gas and use that in big trucks as we see around the cities of America now, where the buses and some of the delivery systems use compressed natural gas. And we will find other ways of using natural gas in stationary engines that will be very efficient, and it will replace to some extent coal and oil. And possibly nuclear, although we hope that not too much nuclear, because nuclear should be able to grow by itself. And nuclear's day will come. It's just that it's been delayed another 20 or 30 years by all these events. But in the end, nuclear will take its place on the pedestal in 20 to 30 years, along with gas and conservation.
Charlie Maxwell, thank you so much for your perspective and your advice on the energy scene. We appreciate it.
Very good.
At the conclusion of every Wealth Track, we give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week, we're taking a different tack, recommending a classic book considered to be the seminal history of the oil industry since its 19th century beginnings. It is Daniel Yergin's 1992 Pulitzer Prize winner, The Prize: The Epic Quest for Oil, Money, and Power. It is replete with the winners and losers, hucksters and heroes, gushers and dry wells, wars and peace surrounding what powered the world into the modern age and remains our dominant fuel source. Next week, we're going to bring you a rare interview with Morningstar's fund manager of the decade, Fairholme Fund's Bruce Berkowitz. Berkowitz will discuss his large and controversial investments in battered financial stocks. We also want to let you know about a new opportunity for those of you who watch Wealth Track on the web. Starting next week, subscribers can see our program as early as Thursday morning, along with timely interviews exclusive to Wealth Track subscribers. For more information, check out our website, wealthtrack.com. And if you haven't already, while you are there, please fill out our confidential and brief viewer survey. On this 10th anniversary of 9/11, we leave you with a moment of prayer and remembrance for all of the loved ones we lost. We will never forget. Thank you for watching, and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Research affiliates, an efficient index for an inefficient market. Wintergreen, your home for global value. And Rosalind P. Walter.